Pat Cleary. I'm a professor of microbiology from the University of Minnesota, and this is my colleague, Dr. Agalliu, here at Columbia University. We joined forces 4 years ago, I guess, to investigate what was a mysterious complication to streptococcal infections. We've known for many, many years about a problem called Sydenham's chorea, which comes on to a child after they've had strep throat and rheumatic fever. But in 1998, Dr. Sue Suido at the Institute of Mental Health described another condition, which was the sudden onset of obsessive-compulsive behavior in children following a streptococcal infection, PANDAS. And what interested me and Dritan was, how does an infection, which doesn't involve an infection of the brain, result in a change in this, in behavior, both motor as well as psychiatric? Group A strep has been called the chain that links the throat to the heart, the brain, and the skin. It's a chain of bacteria that causes very common infections in children, strep throat. And these complications that come on 2 to 4 weeks after a child has had a strep infection are thought to be an autoimmune complication. And the reason that we think that is Dr. Cunningham at University of Oklahoma has discovered autoantibodies in the blood of these kids, both Sydenham's chorea patients as well as kids with the obsessive compulsive behavior syndrome, PANDAS. Prior to this, I had been studying the immune response to strep infections, strep A infections in mice, and we discovered that the primary T cell, that compartment of the immune system, response was a Th17 response. These are very important T cells in multiple sclerosis, and these are T cells that were known to go into the brain. So that gave us a clue. And so we did some mouse experiments where we infect mice by putting strep A in the nose 2 or 3 times. The mice become immune, and then we took the brains out of some of these mice, and sure enough, there were streptococcal-specific T cells in the brains. These T cells persisted for at least 50 days. They could be activated to produce IL-17 cytokines that are known to have an impact on the brain by simply exposing the mice intranasally to the bacteria. These T cells come from the mouse tonsils. What we have discovered is that strep caused this major Th17 response in the mouse tonsil. And then shortly after discovering these T cells in the brains of the mice, we got some tonsils from kids with PANDAS and kids with recurrent streptococcal infections. Tonsils from children are loaded with streptococcal-specific Th17 T cells. At that point, we need to know more about the brain, and that's where Dritan came in.
We decided to do a careful analysis of where these T cells were present in the brain of these mice after multiple infections. And what we found, to our surprise, is that the T cells were actually present in specific regions of the brain. One region in the frontal part of the brain, called the olfactory bulb, had a very high number of T cells. This is a region of the brain that receives information from olfactory sensory axons for the sense of smell and transmit this information to the rest of the brain. So these findings suggested to us that these T cells probably traveled to the brain from the nose, following along the olfactory sensory axons. What are the consequences for these T cells, for the presence of these T cells in the brain, for the function of the blood-brain barrier and neuronal function? So we actually did a simple experiment where at the end of the infection, we injected tracers into the bloodstream of these mice, and then followed where these tracers would end up in the brain. There was a breach in the blood-brain barrier in all the regions of the brain where there were T cells, the olfactory bulb, the lateral hypothalamus, the amygdala, and also other regions of the brain that receive inputs from the olfactory system. We asked whether these antibodies that are circulating can enter the brain. So we actually stained the brains of mice for the presence of these antibodies and found that basically the antibodies were present in all the regions of the brain where there was a broken blood-brain barrier. Finally, we examined the synapses between these neurons because we wanted to know whether there were any neurological consequences. So we examined both the excitatory and inhibitory synapses in the olfactory bulb after multiple recurrent infections. And we found that in fact the excitatory glutamatergic synapses were actually decreased after recurrent strep infections.
We propose that the bacteria are expanding the T cell repertoire in the tonsils of children that are infected over and over again, and at the same time expanding autoantibody that cross-reacts with proteins on the bacteria and proteins in the brain. At some point when the T cell numbers get to a particular level, they migrate into the brain and produce IL-17, which opens up the blood-brain barrier and allows IgG antibody, including autoantibody, to enter the brain. Then, subsequent to the initial onslaught of T cells into the brain, every time a child becomes exposed to strep, those T cells expand and you have an exacerbation of their behavior.
We're continuing some of the work to understand some of the basic mechanisms of the disease, how these T cells get into the brain. Are the streptococcal-specific Th17 cells required for the blood-brain barrier breakdown and synapse damage? So I think that's an important question to answer for the future. I want to introduce here Marianne Platt, who is a graduate student in the neurobiology and behavior program, and she will continue this work here at Columbia University.